Good morning, everyone. May I welcome you once again to Sunday morning worship here at Barnes Baptist Church in the southwest of lockdown London. We're having our first major snowfall this morning here in London, but we pray that our hearts will be warmed by our worship together this morning. Just Esther and myself and Bon and Josh are here to enable this service to be live streamed to you. We thank you for joining us, and we pray that we may all be blessed by this time together. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you that you are the sovereign Lord who is our strength. Thank you, Lord, that as the prophet Habakkuk put, you make our feet like that of the feet of a deer, enabling us to go on to the heights of worship, the heights to be with you. Attune us to you, Lord, we pray, through your Spirit. Bless this time. And in Jesus' name, we would ask forgiveness for sins that would make our worship, our offering, less than acceptable to you this day. Forgive us and cleanse us, we ask in his precious name. Fill us anew, empower, enable, bless us with your Holy Spirit, and lead us on. Amen. Lord, I come to you. We sing together our first song this morning.
Change 10, so we have, we'll have to close the door.
Oh, hello. Hi, sorry. Is it just online?
Yes.
Awesome.
Is that? Is that? Sorry, oh, I thought it was. Oh, sorry, I have to close.
Let us pray.
Is here?
I thought it is like not just online. I thought it's few people they can.
Okay.
But that's fine.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you once again that we're able to gather here this morning. And as we gather, we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his followers as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The next song that we sing reminds us of the Lord's protective hand over our lives, living under the shadow of his wing. Notices. Although we continue in lockdown, the life of the church goes on. And today is actually Unity Sunday across churches in England and Wales and Northern Ireland. And there will be a Unity service being broadcast from St Mary's Church here in Barnes at 4 o'clock via Zoom. Churches together in Barnes, Unity service. From St Mary's at 4 o'clock this afternoon. It's a service of prayers and Bible readings, and if you would like to link up with that service at 4 o'clock this afternoon, please get in touch with me beforehand and I will send you the necessary link, okay? And then every day, of course, we have our own church time of prayer. Wherever you are, please join with us at 9 o'clock for our time of prayer. And then on Wednesday, it's the church prayer meeting. Once again, this will be at 9 o'clock. This Wednesday, 9 o'clock, the church prayer meeting. Again, like all things that seem to happen in the world at this time, it will be accessed via Zoom. So once again, I'll be sending out the necessary details for you to link up with that. And if you have, for any reason, been left out and you want to be part of that church prayer meeting, get in touch with me, I'll send you the necessary link. 4 o'clock, we have the second of our Friday fellowships. And that will be at 8 o'clock, and guess what? It's going to be by Zoom. So again, I'll be sending out links for that. We had a good time of fun last Friday. We had a quiz and then the opportunity just to chat together Friday evening, keeping our fellowship together, having some fun and some laughter. And I'm sure it'll be the same this Friday. Once again, please get in touch with me if you want to participate, and I will send you out the necessary link. And then next Sunday, worship once again at 11 a.m. here in the church. And as usual, we'll be live streaming during this time of lockdown. If you have any questions about any of the notices, again, get in touch with me, email, phone call, and hopefully I'll be able to give you the information you require and request. One of our readings this morning comes from Psalm 22, and Josh is going to read to us Psalm 22 verses 1 to 8 and then 19 to 24.
Psalm 22 verses 1 to 8 and then 19 to 24. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my people. In the assembly I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honour him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help.
We all go through times when we feel troubled mentally, spiritually. Questions, doubts fill our minds. And where do we look? No better place than the cross of Christ to see how God has invested in us, how much he loves us. We sing together how deep the Father's love for us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure.
words in mind, Esther now leads us in prayer.
Would you please join me in prayer? Our God and Father, by your Spirit, we draw to you and come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. And may this prayer be full of the true spirit of praise, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. May this time spent in prayer be truly springing from our hearts, crying to you, Abba, Father. Oh Lord, help us to focus on you and drive away all distracting thoughts and any hindrances that would keep us away from true fellowship with you and with the believers all over the world at this time. We worship you, the only true and living God, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. We ascribe glory and honor and power and praise to him that sits upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Grant us, O Lord, forgiveness for every thought against other people, against our neighbor, against our friends, from every careless word we uttered, from the wrong desires of our hearts, when we fail to live out your word and your will in our lives, forgive us. Look in great mercy upon us, dear Lord. And as we gathered here and everyone joining us online from all over the world, we ask that as we join in our prayer this morning, we pray as the psalmist David prayed, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there's any grievous or unrighteous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." This is our prayer, Lord, so that nothing in our hearts, in the deepest part of our thoughts, is going to hamper all that you have prepared for us today, and that our service be acceptable to you. And today, we give thanks for all that you have been doing in our lives, for the abundant life we have in Jesus, here and now and in the future. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that there is life and hope beyond this pandemic, and that we look forward for that tomorrow, Lord. Thank you for giving us new life through Jesus Christ, your Son. This new, abundant, and eternal life. Thank you. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit who applied that great salvation to us in our lives. And by the Holy Spirit, we can also share this wonderful word of life to those who are yet to believe in your name. We know that we have friends, we have families, we have co-workers, employers, neighbors that are still seeking, searching for the true meaning of life and the true meaning of eternal life. Help us, Lord, to be able to go out to them, speak to them about this great salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. You have blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. You chose us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before Him in love. You predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of your will. You redeemed us, Lord, through your blood, the forgiveness of our sins. And according to your riches of your grace, you lavished on us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of your will, which is in Jesus Christ. You have made us heirs with Christ. And all these spiritual blessings that we receive, Lord, apart from the material blessings that we receive day by day, much more so, we are so thankful for all the spiritual blessings that we have. Spiritual blessings that will never perish. Blessings that we will enjoy and promised to those who believed in Him and were sealed by your Holy Spirit. For this one reason, to the praise of your name, to the glory of your name. Lord, many lives have been changed by this pandemic. Amongst others, fear, panic, anxiety, worry hover above us. And not just this pandemic, Lord, the day-to-day worries that we encounter, Lord, from other illnesses, from other problems. Father, we ask for your deliverance, Lord. Deliver us from the fear of the unknown. Because we have you. You have our future mapped for us. And you know what is ahead of us. So help us, Lord, to rest in your great love. And rest in your will. And rest in your ways. And rest in your promises. And that will all overwhelm us, Lord, and drives away all fear. Work in us, O God, the precious gift of faith, and increase it even more. May we continue to look ahead and joyfully expect the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, our greatest hope, so that all the cares that is troubling us at this very moment, they will all be forgotten when that day comes and Jesus Christ takes us to you. Every day we ask that our love for you and our brethren and our fellow men grow, and that we will show everything that we have in Jesus Christ to them. And work in us as well as we pray, and lead us to follow in every path you are taking us, fixing our eyes on Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. And in his name we pray. Amen.
William Cooper's hymn, "God Moves in a Mysterious Way, His Wonders to Perform."
God moves in a mysterious way.
Let us pray. Once again, Lord, we do thank you for your word, and we pray, Lord, as we have sung, that being our interpreter, you will make plain your work for us. In Jesus' name, amen. On one of the walls at home, I have one of J.W. Turner's most famous paintings, or a print of it. Otherwise, it would be worth millions and millions of pounds. It's entitled Rain, Steam and Speed. And it's a painting of a train of the Great Western Railway crossing over Maidenhead Railway Bridge. The train is moving at speed. It's a day, stormy weather. The rain is blowing in, so much of the actual picture appears at first as a blur. And it's hard to make out all the details if you're standing too close to it. You need to step back a bit, and you need to allow your eyes to adjust. But even then, there are aspects of Turner's painting that only the artist himself will ever know, will ever understand. And what's true of the painting can often seem true of God and his ways, because there is so much that we do not understand, so much that doesn't seem to make sense at times, so much that can leave us feeling puzzled, even angry. And those questions that arise are heightened if we are a man, a woman of faith. If God is love, why does he allow things to go on as they do? Why does he allow so much suffering, so much injustice? Why does he allow, in the words of the writer of Ecclesiastes, righteous men to perish in his righteousness, while the wicked man lives long in his wickedness? Well, we were asking such questions last Sunday, hope you remember, and we looked at what God's word had to say in answer, starting off with that verse in Hebrews chapter 2, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 8. And following the biblical leads that it gives us. But today I want to revisit that question in a different way. The question of what is God doing about the mess we are in? And I want to revisit it from the standpoint of an individual. An individual who, with troubled eyes, looked on the injustices of the world around him and ask, where are you, God, in all this? Where are you, God, in all this? If you have a Bible available, you might like to turn to the minor prophet Habakkuk. Habakkuk. And I'm just going to read the first four verses of Habakkuk. The prophecy that Habakkuk, the prophet, received. How long, Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. Now, we know virtually nothing about Habakkuk. But we know quite a bit about the world in which he lived. Habakkuk lived at the turn between the 7th and 6th centuries BC in Judah. And he lived in a world of political turmoil, with the three superpowers of Babylon on the rise, Egypt on the decline, and Assyria pretty much finished battling for supremacy and for survival. And in the middle of all this superpower manoeuvring sat the little nation of Judah, her successive kings playing a dangerous and ultimately disastrous game of political brinkmanship, allying themselves first with one superpower and then with another. And if that didn't bode trouble, well, Judah itself had become a land where God's law had been forsaken by many, where violence, injustice, corruption, and social malaise all evidenced the nation's breaking of its covenant relationship with God. So these were dark and dangerous times that Habakkuk lived in, times which we might feel some way resemble our own. And it's in this context, a world perhaps so like our own, that Habakkuk, the prophet, cries out in complaint to God, lamenting the injustices of his own society, but also pouring out his anger, his frustration, his anger to God. This is another translation of verses 2 to 5 that I've just read out. God, how long do I have to cry out for help before you listen? How many times do I have to yell, help, murder, police, before you come to the rescue? Why do you force me to look at evil, store trouble in the face day after day? Anarchy and violence break out, quarrels and fights all over the place. Law and order fall to pieces. Justice is a joke. The wicked have the righteous hamstrung and stand justice on its head. Now, I said last week that one of the reasons that I love God's word is because of its honesty. It deals with real people, real emotions, real problems, and it gives, I believe, the real solution. But haven't you ever felt like Habakkuk? Haven't you ever asked God these same questions? Why such suffering? Why such injustice? Where are you, God, and what are you doing about it all? Well, if you haven't, I fear there might be something lacking in your faith, your understanding of God, not to mention your sense of justice. But if you have asked questions like this, if the state of the world does trouble you, then like Habakkuk, you're echoing a question that recurs again and again throughout the Bible and from God's own people. Here's Job. I cry out to you, O God, but you do not answer. Have I not wept for those in trouble? Has not my soul grieved for the poor? Yet when I hoped for good, evil comes. When I looked for light, then came darkness. You are always righteous, O Lord, declares Jeremiah, when I bring a case before you. Yet I would speak to you about your justice. Why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why do all the faithless live at ease? And then even in the New Testament, the voice of the martyrs cry out in the book of Revelation, how long, sovereign Lord? How long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, will it be until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? Where are you, God, in all this? Why do you tolerate this mess? Where is your justice? Don't you care? What are you doing about it? Well, sometimes in the Bible, the answer does not come, at least not immediately. Sometimes things need to be worked out before the answer already given appears, becomes clear. Sometimes, as with that painting, Rain, Steam and Speed, we need to stand back from things in order to get a better perspective, to better understand the full picture. But sometimes, as was the case here with Habakkuk, the answer does come quickly. God does speak. And so for Habakkuk, the answer comes. But much to Habakkuk's dismay, the Lord's answer contains good news, but good news that is tempered by what for Habakkuk is bad, bad news. No, God says, he isn't deaf, neither is he blind. He knows what the problem is with Judah, and it's something that he is not going to ignore. Yes, Habakkuk, justice will be done. But the bad news is the way God's justice is going to be done. God is going to use the mighty Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own, verse 6, to bring his justice down on his own people. And no wonder Habakkuk is upset. The plan is outrageous. Verse 13 of chapter 1. Your eyes, he says to God, are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? In other words, how could you, God, do such a thing? How could you use a nation that is so ruthless and impetuous, God's own description of the Babylonians, to bring judgment on your own people, who for all their shortcomings are not as evil as the Babylonians are? So Habakkuk is bewildered. He's completely flummoxed. He's perplexed. And he's now wishing, perhaps, that he'd never asked God the question in the first place. I mean, it's enough of struggle for a man of faith to believe that God is good and God is just when there is so much evil in the world. But to hear God say that he is going to use a people like the Babylonians as his instrument, well, that is too much. Habakkuk is speechless. He doesn't know what to say. He doesn't know what to say. Instead, he depicts himself in chapter 2, verse 1, like a watchman standing on the city wall, waiting, looking for God's further response. And you know, when times are tough, and they are tough at the moment for many of us, when we struggle to make sense of what's happening in the world around us, it's so important that we, like Habakkuk, amidst all our fears and questions, maintain unbroken relationship with God and with one another. Because we will need one another's support. Our fellow believers will need us, and we will need them as much as we still need God. And then the time will come when God, through word or through deed, will indeed speak to us. But however high our metaphorical watchtower, however deep, in other words, our faith, however our sensitivity to God's Spirit, there are times when we simply cannot see beyond the immediate horizon. But be assured, God is at work, and not always in ways we would expect, and sometimes not even in ways we would approve. Blessed are those, said Jesus, who have seen, who have not seen, and yet have believed. You see, our faith must necessarily extend beyond physical sight and mental understanding. The righteous will live by his faith. And when in chapter 2 God again speaks to Habakkuk, he reveals to the prophet that although things will get worse before they get better, Habakkuk can be assured that God will indeed do that which is right. But he will do it in his own way, and he will do it in his own time. The Babylonians themselves will not escape God's justice. In time, the nation that God is using to judge Judah will themselves be judged by him. Chapter 2, verse 8. Because you have plundered many nations, God is saying to them, the people who are left will plunder you, for you have shed man's blood. You have destroyed lands and cities and everyone in them. But the rise and the fall of Babylon is only one aspect of what God is doing. And through the rest of his exchange with God, Habakkuk comes to realize that God has a far greater understanding of things than he has. A far greater understanding of the picture, and a longer term view as well. Indeed, Habakkuk is even given a brief glimpse of a far off and yet wonderful future when all the world will acknowledge God and live according to his ways. Chapter 2, verse 14, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And in the light of that brief glimpse, that brief vision, and in the knowledge of the God who knows, and the God who cares, and the God who is just, and whose will be done, Habakkuk will, through the trials and tribulations that are, and the trials and tribulations that are to come, wait patiently for the day of calamity to come on the nation invading us. And though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vine, he says, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, although there are no sheep in the pen or cattle in the stalls, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Saviour. It's chapter 3, verses 16 through to 17. So William Cowper wrote his hymn. God moves in a mysterious way his wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. Blind unbelief is sure to err and scan his works in vain. God is his own interpreter. and he will make it plain. In our experiences, we too must dare, like Habakkuk, to trust God. As someone has written, no paralyzing panic, no irresponsible escapism, no morbid pessimism, but firm faith should characterize God's people. And like a pilot who's flying his plane through the fog, like that pilot needs his instruments to check against his own judgment, so we too need the objective truth of God's own word to balance our subjective feelings. And we need each other as well. Because our perspective on life is so limited, whilst God's, of course, is limitless. We cannot see all that he's doing, and we cannot see all that he will do. But we can have absolute confidence in the justice of God, and that what he does is always right. And knowing this should bring us confidence and hope in the midst of what is for us a very confusing world. At the moment, we stand too near to the painting. In fact, we're part of it. But one day, Jesus promises to take us to that place where the whole canvas of God's plan will be revealed to us. And what we see then, in terms of God's justice and in terms of God's grace, will fill our hearts with wonder and thanksgiving. But until then, the righteous, like Habakkuk, will live by faith. Let us pray. Lord of all, sometimes we stand with Habakkuk questioning. So much that is unknown, so much that doesn't seem to make sense, so much that causes us anger at times. But Lord, we thank you that, like Habakkuk, you have revealed to us that you are the God of justice, of righteousness, of love. And so amidst our unknowing and questions, we say again, our hope, our trust is in you. Lord, hear the cry of our hearts as we bring before you now, in this moment of silence, those things that trouble us. Lord, you have heard. Help us now to hear you. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn, once again, one of those great old hymns that gets to the very root of things. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord. going on this week, and once again, questions about any of it, please do contact me. If you haven't got my phone number, if you haven't got the email, they're now on the church website. You can easily Google that and the details are there. But we do hope you will be able to join us for the church prayer meeting on Wednesday and for the Friday fellowship as well. And of course, next Sunday, as we continue our live streaming during this time of lockdown. But thank you for being with us today, and let's just share together the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.
Have a lovely Sunday, and see you soon.